안녕하세요. 친한미국 약사입니다. 오늘 이 영상을 준비한 이유는 여러분이 진짜 장수과학이 어떻게 논의되고 있는지 직접 확인할 수 있는 기회를 드리고 싶었기 때문입니다. 해외에서는 이미 세계적인 장수학회와 연구자들이 활발하게 토론을 이어가고 있습니다. 그동안 이런 소식들을 제가 알기 쉽게 정리하여 알려드렸는데요. 이제는 여러분 스스로 그 과학자들의 목소리를 직접 듣고 시각을 넓히는 경험을 하셨으면 합니다. 특히 오늘 영상은 세계적인 과학 커뮤니케이터인 스탠퍼드 의대 앤드류 휴버먼 교수의 팟캐스트에 하버드 의대 데이비드 싱클레어 박사가 출연하여 노화는 질병인가, 후성 유전체 리프로그래밍, 그리고 최신 장수과학의 핵심 개념들을 깊이 있게 나누는 대화입니다. 세계적인 과학자들의 대화를 직접 들어보면 그들의 대화가 톤과 매너가 다르다는 걸 느끼실 거예요. 과장이나 확정적 표현이 없는 사실 중심의 태도를 볼 수 있습니다. 그리고 이것은 스스로 우리가 건강관리를 위한 판단의 근육을 키우고 여러 혼란스러운 건강정보의 그 진위와 과장을 구분하는 필터링 능력을 강화하는 데 도움이 될 거예요. 오늘 영상은 여러분의 이해를 돕기 위해 제가 번역과 과학 영상을 직접 제작했습니다. 그럼 이제 세계 최전선에서 활동하는 두 과학자들의 대화를 즐겁게 감상해 주세요.
I'm Andrew Huberman, and I'm a professor of neurobiology and ophthalmology at Stanford School of Medicine. And now, my conversation with Dr. David Sinclair. Thanks for being here. I have a ton of questions for you about aging, longevity, lifespan, actionable protocols to increase how long we live, etc. And I just want to start off with a very simple question. What is the difference between longevity, anti-aging, and aging as a disease? Because I associate you with the statement, aging is a disease.
Right. Well, so longevity is the more academic way we describe what we research. Anti-aging is kind of the same thing, but it's got a bad rap because it's been used by a whole bunch of people that don't know what they're talking about. So I really don't like that term, anti-aging. But aging as a disease and longevity are perfectly valid ways to talk about this subject. So let's talk about aging as a disease. When I started my research, disease here at Harvard Medical School, it was considered, if there's something that's wrong with you, and it's a rare thing, has to be less than 50% of the population, that's definitely a disease. And then people work their whole lives to try and cure that condition. And so I looked up what's the definition of aging, and it says, well, it's a deterioration in health and sickness, and you can die from it. Typically you do. Something that sounds pretty much like a disease, but the caveat is that if more than half the population gets this condition, aging, it's put in a different bucket, which is, first of all, that's outrageous because it's just a totally arbitrary cutoff. But think about this, that we're ignoring the major cause of all these diseases. Aging is 80 to 90% the cause of heart disease, Alzheimer's. If we didn't get old and our bodies stayed youthful, we would not get those diseases. And actually what we're showing in my lab is if you turn the clock back in tissues, those diseases go away. So aging is the problem. And instead, through most of the last 200 years, we've been sticking band-aids on diseases that have already occurred because of aging, and then it's too late. So there are a couple of things. One is we want to slow aging down so we don't get those diseases. And when they do occur, don't just stick a band-aid on, reverse the age of the body, and then the diseases will go away.
That clarifies a lot for me. Thank you. Can we point to one specific general phenomenon in the body that underlies aging?
Fortunately, during the 2000s, we settled on 8 or 9 major causes of aging. These 8 or 9 causes, at least for the first time, allowed us to come around and talk together. We put them on a pizza, so everyone got equal slices. But I think that there's one slice of the pizza that is way larger than the others. And we can get to that, but that's the information in the cell that we call the epigenome.
Well, tell us a little bit more about the epigenome, frame it for us, if you will, and then we'll get into ways that one can adjust the epigenome in positive ways.
Yeah, so in science, what I like to do, I'm a reductionist, is to boil it down. And I actually ended up boiling aging down to an equation, which is the loss of information due to entropy. it's a hard thing to overcome the second law of thermodynamics. That's fair. But this equation really represents the fact that I think aging is a loss of information in the same way that when you Xerox something, I mean, 1,000 times, you'll lose that information, or you try to copy a cassette tape, or even if you send information across the internet, some of it will get lost. That's what I think is aging. And there are two types of information in the body. There is the genetic information, which is digital, ATCG, the chemical letters of DNA. But there's this other part of the information in the body that's just as important. It's essential, in fact, and that's the systems that control which genes are switched on and off, in what cell, at what time, in response to what we eat, etc. And it turns out that 80% of our future longevity and health is controlled by this second part, the epigenetic information, the control systems. I liken the DNA to the music that's on a DVD or a compact disc for the younger people who used to use these things.
I recall.
Yeah. And then the epigenome is the reader that says, okay, in this cell, we need to play that set of songs. And in this other cell, we have to play a different set of songs. But over time, aging is the equivalent of scratching the CD and the DVD so that you're not playing the right songs. And cells, when they don't hear the right songs, they get messed up and they don't function well. And that is what I'm saying is the main driver of aging. And these other hallmarks are largely manifestations of that process.
What are the scratches that you're referring to?
So DNA is 6 foot long. So if you join your chromosomes together, you get about 6 foot per cell. So there's enough to go to the moon and back 8 times in your body. And it has to be wrapped up to exist inside us. But it's not just wrapped up willy-nilly. It's not just a bundle of string. It's wrapped up very carefully in ways that dictates which genes are switched on and off. And when we're developing in the embryo, the cell marks the DNA with chemicals that says, okay, this gene is for a nerve cell. You cell will stay a nerve cell for the next 100 years, if you're lucky. Don't turn into a skin cell. That would be bad. And those chemicals, there are many different types of chemicals, but one's called methylation. Those little methyls will mark which songs get played for the rest of your life. And there are other marks that change daily. But in toto, what we're saying is that the body controls the genome through the ability to mark the DNA and then compact some parts of it, silence those genes, don't read those genes, and open others, keep others open, that should stay open. And that pattern of genes that are silent, open, is what dictates the cell's type, the cell's function. And then the scratches are the disruption of that. So genes that were once silent, and you could say it's a gene that is involved in skin, it's starting to come on in the brain, shouldn't be there, but we see this happen, and vice versa, the gene might get shut off over time during aging. Cells over time lose these structures, lose their identity, they forget what they're supposed to do, and we get diseases. We call that aging, and we can measure that. In fact, we can measure it in such a way that we can predict when somebody's going to die based on the changes in those chemicals.
Are these changes the same sorts of changes that underlie the outward body surface manifestations of aging that most of us are familiar with? Graying of the hair, wrinkling of the skin, drooping of the face? Or are we talking about people that are potentially going to look older but simply live longer?
Well, it's actually, you are as old as you look, if you want to generalize. So let's start with centenarian families. These are families that tend to live over 100. When they're 70, they still look 50 or less. So it is a good indicator. It's not perfect because you can, like me, grow up in Australia and accelerate the aging of your skin. But in general, how you look. No one's ever died from gray hair, but overall you can get a sense just from the ability of skin to hold itself up, how thin it is, the number of wrinkles.
Very interesting.